welcome to worship in the Unitarian Universalist Church of Charlotte. I invite you not to check your melancholy at the door today. We talk of individual and communal healing and the pain that makes it necessary. Healing is a process without a definite end point. It's work we should not do alone. As Anne Barker writes, we gather with a hunger for reconciliation. What is done cannot be undone. What is done next must now be done with care. We gather because we are hopeful, because we have dreams and visions of a brighter future, that there may be more than vision in this room. These are the wounds we must heal together, grief and anger for all that has been lost, guilt or fear in the reliving, pain that has gone without sufficient comfort, mistrust that was earned and continues burning still. These are the wounds we will tend cautiously. She says, applying the salve of understanding, forming scars that mark our history without disfiguring the future we might share. We are new to this endeavor, Anne Barker says, new at listening, new at hearing, new at taking enough time to honestly receive one another's stories. What is done cannot be undone. What is done next must now be done with care. We gather because we have visions and dreams of a brighter future. Welcome, members. Welcome, guests. Welcome, all. And as we prepare to sing, would you turn and welcome the people around you?
Thank you. we light this chalice as a symbol of our faith. As we approach our time together, let us remember that we are doing the work of this congregation. When we do the work of this congregation, we touch lives. When we touch lives, we touch the world. May the light of truth illuminate our vision. May the work of love set our hearts on fire, now and always.
Our first reading is a poem by Bell Hooks from her collection, Appalachian Elegy. Such then is beauty surrendered. Against all hope, you are here again, turning slowly. Nature as chameleon, all life change and changing again, awakening hearts, steady moving from unnamed loss into fierce, deep grief that can bear all burdens, even the long passage into a shadowy dark where no light enters.
Our next reading is by David White. Honesty is reached through the doorway of grief and loss, where we cannot go in our mind, our memory, or our body, is where we cannot be straight with one another, with the world, or with ourselves. Every human being dwells intimately close to a door of revelation they are afraid to pass through. Honesty lies in understanding our close and necessary relationship with not wanting to hear the truth. Honesty is not a weapon to keep loss and heartbreak at bay. Honesty is the outer diagnostic of our ability to come to ground in reality, the hardest attainable ground of all, the place where we actually dwell.
In Toni Morrison's novel, Beloved, one of the main characters is a woman named Setha. The book is set in the decade after the Emancipation Proclamation, and Setha is always remembering slavery and the things that were done to her body. Setha's back is knotted with the scars of past violence. She calls the mass of scars her cherry choke tree, unable to see them properly, but imagining how they converge and separate into the pattern of something living, something ever present, twisting around her spine. Not long into reading, we find that Setha's past terror and suffering is not even past. It's a physical presence in the home she shares with her daughter, Denver, something like a ghost, something angry, scared, and lonely that rearranges things in the night, violent and needy. In turn, Denver is overwhelmed by the presence of her mother's past suffering. No one ever wants to come visit them in their haunted house. And Denver longs for the company of anyone who is not a ghost or her haunted mother. Denver knows somehow that their pain and isolation will continue until they can face this ghost of past trauma and put it to rest. Dr. Bessel van der Kolk spent his career studying how people are affected by traumatic experience. In his book, The Body Keeps the Score, van der Kolk describes meeting Tom, a man who had recently returned from fighting in the Vietnam War. Tom did not contemplate things that happened in the past, sifting through memories at will. Instead, without warning, a flood of memory and feeling would overtake him. His rational mind would retreat, leaving him awash in fear. The past would invade the present. A memory of an experience in Vietnam was not something Tom could hold at arm's length and ponder and process. Sounds and smells that reminded Tom of combat would send his body into a fight or flight mode. He might scream and throw things across the room, scaring his family. Or he would drink until his senses were dull and unable to provoke internal terror. And the more Tom tried to avoid remembering his past, the more his past invaded and eclipsed his present life. Van der Kolk observed Tom and others suffering the aftershocks of trauma and helped determine the symptoms and the treatment for post-traumatic stress disorder. Van der Kolk noticed that the more his patients tried to avoid or bury their past, the more they were doomed to live and relive it endlessly. To live with their trauma, Van der Kolk suggested that patients find a way to repair the connection between the conscious mind and their emotions. If they could not meld thought and feeling successfully, they would never be able to make meaning of their past experiences. Instead, patients would be trapped in compulsion, repeating the same harmful behavior again and again. The West Indian poet Edouard Glissant asks, "Would it be ridiculous to consider our lived history as a steadily advancing neurosis? To see the slave trade as a traumatic shock, our relocation in the new land as a repressive phase, slavery as the period of latency when trauma lies unexamined and waiting." Emancipation, he says, in 1848, as reactivation. Our everyday fantasies as symptoms of our horror of returning to those things of the past. Glissant speaks of colonialism, the act of white Europeans taking political control of societies of people of color, occupying their land with settlers, and exploiting the resources of the colonized to benefit the colonizers. Glissant describes colonialism as a traumatic event and wonders how this wound of history might heal. How does a society, our society, heal from the forced relocation of American Indians, the intentional extermination of languages, spiritual traditions, cultures, people? How does a society, our society, heal from chattel slavery, from the colonization of women's bodies? In his work with patients suffering from post-traumatic stress, Dr. Bessel van der Kolk determined that if patients could heal the connection between their mind and their emotions, they would be able to reflect on and make meaning of their past experiences. Only then would they escape the repetitive hell of reliving their past over and over. Only then would they recover their agency. Van der Kolk determined that healing the connection between intellect and emotion required a seemingly paradoxical treatment. They would need to immerse themselves in memories of the very pain that had caused their trauma, intentionally and regularly returning to their past until they could sit with the details of what happened without running away. As Vandercock wrote in his early observations of this treatment method, "I soon discovered how excruciating it can be to face reality." On the 100th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation, James Baldwin wrote a letter to his beloved nephew. He wanted his namesake to think about what this anniversary meant as a Black teenager living in the United States in the 1960s. Even if, as Baldwin says, the country was celebrating 100 years of freedom, 100 years too soon. In that letter, Baldwin says, "White people are in effect, still trapped in a history which they do not understand. And until they understand it, they cannot be released from it. They have had to believe for many years and for innumerable reasons that Black people are inferior to white people." Baldwin continues, "Many of them indeed know better, but as you will discover, people find it very difficult to act on what they know. To act is to be committed, and to be committed is to be in danger," Baldwin says. In this case, the danger in the minds of most white Americans is the loss of their identity. There is no cure for trauma, individual or collective. That is because what happened in the past cannot be undone. What was lost will always be lost. But we can heal from trauma. As Dr. Vandercock discovered, the treatment involves immersing ourselves in memories of the very pain that caused the trauma, learning the stories in our shared history that we don't know, learning the stories we have not wanted to know in our collective past, intentionally and regularly returning to study our shared history until we can sit with the details of reality, of what really happened, without running away. Truth is the starting point of that healing. As we heard from David White earlier, every human being dwells intimately close to a door of revelation they are afraid to pass through. He says, honesty is not a weapon to keep loss and heartbreak at bay. Honesty is the outer diagnostic of our ability to come to ground in reality, the hardest attainable ground of all, the place where we actually dwell. That reality is the trauma of our collective history. The neurosis and patterns we share and have never yet learned to escape. Sigmund Freud wrote that the successful working through of trauma enables the victim eventually to free themselves from the grip of mechanisms of repetition. It's by immersing ourselves in past pain that we work through trauma, immersing ourselves in what is difficult to know. In our healing from trauma, we reconnect our ability to think with our ability to feel. When we cannot connect our thinking and our feeling, we can make We cannot make meaning of the past and rediscover our agency, our moral will, our ability to act out of conscience rather than compulsion, to create together a different future. May we cause it to be so. Amen.
Welcome. We're happy you're with us today in this room or joining us remotely. We're pleased to have guests with us. Our members would like to greet you personally following the service. So if you are visiting, please raise your hand and keep it up. Members, take note of those seated near you After the service, invite them to join you for coffee and conversation in Freeman Hall. Should it enhance your experience of future services, you can find both a large print order of service and a personal hearing assistance device on the table at the entrance to the sanctuary. Also, an elevator is located to the left of the entrance. If you'd like to learn more about us, please fill out a yellow card and place it in the offering basket later in the service. Members with a life event to share can do so on the reverse side of the card. The cards and offering envelopes are on the clipboards at the end of the row. Please begin passing them now. Visitors interested in hearing about how to become a member can talk with our membership coordinator, Kelly Green. Her contact information is on the back of your order of service. Again, to each of you, welcome. In 2014, I was privileged to join a choir tour to South Africa. This was the fulfillment of a long-held dream to visit Africa. I did not know it would change my life. We were guided for the two-week tour by Pieter, a descendant of Dutch immigrants during the 1600s, an Afrikaner. As he narrated our tour, I began to realize that South African history closely paralleled that of the United States. This included discovery of the country in 1488, colonization, primarily by British and Dutch, acquisition of land by moving people off the native people off the land, civil war, student riots, civil rights actions, and more. Our visit included a trip to the Apartheid Museum in Soweto. The terrifying reign of white over black was clearly and heartrendingly displayed. A question arose for me about the idea of supremacy of white over black. When and where did this begin? Why did it start? I did not receive an answer to that question for 4 more years. I soon noticed something different about South Africa, something unspoken, unseen, beneath conscious awareness. Throughout our tour, our guide described actions by the government, begun by Nelson Mandela, to right the wrongs of apartheid. Houses were being built and given to people who had suffered under racism. One area of development is a beautiful hillside, and you see the picture in front of you, overlooking Cape Town at the foot of Table Mountain. The houses of wealthy white people had been purchased and were torn down to build housing for the African natives who were displaced by the colonial people. And that area is the grassy area with the trees that you see on the left. That housing is being given, owned by the recipients. Houses are also being built and given to those who live in the squalid settlements around the big cities. I was amazed by this form of reparations. Maybe these actions were creating the feeling of well-being that I was experiencing. On my return, I looked up a timeline of South African history. Only two differences stood out. One was the time of our constitutions. Ours was in 1789, and theirs in 1997. South Africa also had experienced a period of intentional reconciliation between the perpetrators of the apartheid system and its native African victims. When officials came clean, detailing their actions and the effects face to face with survivors or their families, healing could begin, and it did. Forgiveness of the perpetrators was part of the process. Is that the source of the something in the air? I don't know, but I think so. And what about the question of how all this did begin? When did people of darker color being treated as less than? It did not begin with the slave trade in the 1500s. It did not begin with American slavery. It dates back to Greco-Roman times. White people have thought that darker skins indicated inferiority for at least 2,000 years. My explorations based on these questions have led me to participate in our church's racial studies. I have read widely. I teach classes in racism. In the end, I wish deeply that our country could experience truth and reconciliation so that I could feel the way I do about South Africa in my own country. In the class I teach for the Urban Ministry Center, I ask these questions of the participants, and now I'm asking them of you. How do you deprive people of color of educational opportunities and call them stupid? How do you discriminate in opportunities for work and call them lazy? How do you deprive them of opportunity and call them incapable? These kind of questions call us to be honest about the bias we are now called to face.
But I have the evil of the world, so I
If you'd like to learn more ways to engage in the life of our congregation, you can read through the back of your order of service, or explore our website, or subscribe to our weekly e-newsletter, Currents. Thank you to everyone who has contributed to the Greening Our Facility capital campaign. We're 2/3 of the way to our goal, and there are only a few days left to make it there. So if you have not yet contributed, I hope you will go to Freeman Hall, to the table there, to make your contribution and help us flip the switch on our solar panels to start generating our own clean power. If you're planning to attend the 12:30 session in the Bernstein Room today with the board to keep talking about the proposed changes to the bylaws, we wanted you to know that childcare will be provided. Let us remember that we do not follow the path of healing alone. In the moments you find yourself questioning your strength, feeling weary or desolate, return here. Return here to this company and remember that you are not alone. We are sending our love and prayers for healing to the Jewish community of Poway, California. And we send love and healing prayers to the people of Sri Lanka. Here in our own community, we hold with love Jan McNeely as she mourns the death of her mother. We hold in our hearts and prayers Simone and Suzanne Lake as they mourn the death of Simone's husband and Suzanne's father, Dick Lake. You are welcome to join us for a celebration of Dick's life Saturday, May 11th, here in this sanctuary at 11 a.m. If you have a sorrow or a joy or a remembrance that feels particularly meaningful to you today, later in the service when the offering baskets are being passed and music is being played, you're welcome, member and visitor alike, to come forward and light a candle in silence. Would you be with me now in prayer? And this particular prayer is a poem written by Rainer Maria Rilke. God speaks to each of us as God makes us, then walks with us silently out of the night. These are the words we dimly hear. You, sent out beyond your recall, go to the limits of your longing. Embody me. Flare up like a flame and make big shadows I can move in. Let everything happen to you, beauty and terror. Just keep going. No feeling is final. Don't let yourself lose me. Nearby is the country they call life. You will know it by its seriousness. Give me your hand. Amen.
Some of us are excited and proud of the work our congregation is doing. Some of us are scared. If you are in the first group, give what you can to make the endeavor successful. If you are in the second group, give as much as you can to support the first group. The offering will now be given and received. Please join me in an affirmation of our faith, rising in body or in spirit. May the strength of this time together help us to walk forward.
Again, the words of Ann Barker. May we tend to our wounds, applying the salve of understanding, forming scars that mark our history without disfiguring the future we might share. Please be seated.